Next up, we have a talk from Andrew Knodt of Lockheed Martin about testing GPS systems.
Hello, everyone. My name is Andrew Knodt. I'm a software engineer at Lockheed Martin, and I wanted to talk to you today about a GPS monitoring station receiver that we've been developing. It's a software-defined radio and how we tested it. Before we get started on that, I wanted to give a little bit of a system background on GPS. There's three major segments of GPS: user segment, space segment, and control segment. So the user segment is the one that we all of us know and use. That is the equipment that actually forms our position, velocity, and time solutions that we use every day in our phones and, you know, standalone devices. There are, I think, an estimated 4 billion GPS devices currently in use today. So it's a ubiquitous system, as everybody knows. Some of the portions that you may not, most people don't think about are probably the space segment and the control segment. The space segment is kind of what it sounds like. These are the satellites that transmit the GPS signals that the user segment uses to form the solutions. The control segment is probably the least familiar aspect of GPS to most people. This is really the this is the part that is closing the loop between the user segment and the space system, space segment, to make sure that the system provides the level of service and quality that we're all accustomed to. So it really makes sure the system is performing well and commands the satellites to tell them what to do. A little bit more about the control segment. So there are 31 satellites currently operational. There's a couple spares, but the control segment communicates all the time with these satellites. They are in charge of monitoring the health and status of all the subsystems on the satellites, and to make sure that anything that goes wrong, that they will basically protect the users from experiencing bad solutions and try to get them back online as fast as possible. Another very significant part about the control segment is they are the entity responsible for the orbit and clock estimation of all the satellites. The orbit and clock estimation parameters are what makes satellite navigation possible, and gives us the determines the accuracy of our solutions on the ground. So just a little context about where the control segment operates. Just quick background. You can see it has a worldwide presence. There are a number of functions that it performs, like I said, controlling the satellites, commanding them, telling them what to do. But for the purpose of this discussion, we'll just be looking at the where the locations of the blue circles are, which are Hawaii, Colorado, Cape Canaveral, a couple rocks in the middle of the ocean, Ascension Island, Diego Garcia, and Kwajalein. So what exactly is a monitoring station receiver anyway? It's a specialized GPS receiver that's dedicated to making measurements as accurately as possible to each satellite from a monitoring station. So this is really the foundation for all the orbit and clock estimation that's performed by the control segment. So the more accurate the measurements, the better accuracy of the orbit and clock estimation, and the better solutions on the ground, more accurate solutions for everybody who has a GPS receiver. One of the unique things about a monitoring station receiver that's different than a normal receiver that's in a phone is that it needs to be able to track and follow satellites even when they're unhealthy. If there is a problem, the control segment can command the satellite to go into to mark itself as unhealthy, so it doesn't basically poison the navigation solution for everybody on Earth, or anyone who's in view of that satellite at that point. So they can mark it unhealthy, or they can actually push it to reserved or special signals that wouldn't even get picked up by your GPS device. And that's one of the critical responsibilities of the control segment. Couple things, a few more differences, and then we'll get into how we tested this. But the way I like to think about the differences between a normal receiver and a monitoring station receiver is that in a normal receiver, you don't know where you are, and you have no idea what time it is. So that's the goal of a normal receiver, is to figure that out. It can only get that information from, you need at least four satellites in view to extract that information, and of the timing of the signals, and the satellites are broadcasting those orbital and clock correction parameters to the user to compensate for any errors on the vehicle. In a monitoring station receiver, it's quite different. They're still using the same, we're still using the same exact signals to track, but in this case, we know exactly where we are because we've been surveyed. So that information is known, and the clock is actually known as well. It's a common time reference that all the monitoring station receivers are slave to, and uses an atomic clock for stability. So a little bit about the project that we were lucky enough to get involved with. The existing monitoring station receivers have incredible performance, great performance, but they're becoming difficult and expensive to maintain. They were designed over 20 years ago. It's difficult to get parts, or it's a long turnaround time to fix them. Basically, the government asked us to look into an alternative. Could we do this with a non-proprietary set of hardware, something that could be upgraded over time easily, so they wouldn't be tied into a fixed solution that would run into these obsolescence issues. So they were wondering, could you do this with a software-defined radio? And that's where we got involved, and we've been working the past year to prove the accuracy of this, and it's still a work in progress, but I'm pleased to report that the solutions or the measurement accuracy that we're getting is comparable or exceeds the existing legacy receivers. Just a couple words about the implementation. It custom-built software-defined radio. We built it with C++, standard template library, and Boost. We've run on a couple different flavors of Linux. And one of the things I think that separates us from some of the other software-defined radio architectures, although I know there are others that are doing this, but we use NVIDIA GPUs for our acceleration of our signal processing, so to do a lot of the heavy lifting, so that's in CUDA. We also have a plugin-based architecture, and the point of that is really to, we focus on well-defined interfaces, which helps promote testability, but we also, this really allows for the separation of our front-end equipment for RF processing from the rest of our software. So as an example, we have a plugin that provides digital samples. That's the interface. Well, those digital samples could come from a file, they could come over a socket, or they could actually communicate with a hardware board that is doing signal acquisition, analog to digital converter. And so if a company that manufactured one of these boards went out of business, we could write another. It's sort of analogous to a device driver. So we can switch things very rapidly, which also helps for testing. So a couple things about testing, what kind of methods we have. Well, so we, of course, have lots of unit and focused integration, small integration tests, and continuous integration. Every engineer can kick off all the unit tests, and when on a push to a repository of a commit, it's basically going to recompile everything and run all the unit tests for regression, and then it's going to notify everybody on the project whether what was pushed and whether it succeeded or failed, and public shaming can begin if there is failure. So while this is great, I mean, this is really mandatory, it doesn't capture the entire, the complexity of the system. How do we know that these individually tested signal processing algorithms are really going to play well together and give us the accuracy of the measurements that we're looking for? So a couple things we could do. Well, okay, we could just stick an antenna outside and start collecting GPS signals. That's one way to do it. But how do you know? There's some significant problems with this approach, just by itself. How do we test these sort of infrequent events, like when a satellite is unhealthy? And fortunately, that is a fairly infrequent event. From a testing perspective, it might be nice if it was more frequent. But and if we do see something that's unexpected, how do we know what caused the error? Was it a you know, was it a temperature fluctuation? Was it something in our antenna? Was it actually our algorithms themselves, some breaking change that we introduced? Or was it an actual real-world effect, like the it's cloudy one day and sunny the next, and that affects the troposphere, which affects the, or that's part of the troposphere, which affects delays. So, and even if we did uncover some kind of boundary condition, we couldn't reproduce it. So, well, we could just record all of these and play them back. Okay, if we play back at RF, it's going to be not entirely deterministic, because every time you play back at RF, you're going to introduce some thermal noise, and noise is always going to look a little different every time. So we could instead maybe play back at baseband. So if we do that, then we achieve our determinism, but we still have the issue of capturing these sort of infrequent events in the first place. And it's also not very practical for a local system. This isn't designed to go into a cloud. This is really for a small, you know, isolated network. So if we wanted to deliver a test capability along with the system, we'd have to have hundreds of 6-hour satellite passes, and at the sample rates we run at, each pass is about 4 terabytes, and you're going to start getting into the petabyte regime, which it's achievable, but it, for a local system, it's just not very practical or cost effective. We could purchase a commercial GPS simulator. That's not bad, but again, they're expensive, so if we wanted every developer to have one, that really adds to the cost. It can be difficult to script your various scenarios that you want to do, and it's hard to recreate these. Some of these special, very few offer the ability to do these non-standard satellite performance things. So why not create our own simulator? We should already have all the parts that we need. We've been unit testing all of our algorithms on the receive side, so we should be able to know a lot of the things that stimulate it. We should be, if we understand how to build the signal or receive the signal, we should know how to build it. So the test code can really serve as a good foundation for the complementary side. And while this is great because now we can do our own RF testing and have our own source of truth, we can also do baseband testing. And so why is baseband testing so effective? Well, it really allows you, I think one of the critical things is it allows you to separate RF effects from your algorithm performance. So you can run a baseband, get a baseline, and understand what, you know, measurement noise you have. And then when you add your RF hardware in, you can isolate that error. And you can trade between different pieces of hardware to see what effects that it has. You don't need the large disk storage. You can basically just deterministically make the samples on the fly to stimulate your receiver. It's deterministic because, again, we're at baseband. So if you did have some boundary condition you uncovered, it gives you the chance to find it and reproduce it. So it's always joyous when we are actually able to find a problem at baseband because it makes it easier to fix. And it's easily distributable. So every engineer can have at their desk a way to run these complex scenarios. They may have differences in capacity, the number of channels that they can do simultaneously, but still there are, it's a pretty powerful tool. So a couple words about what we found to be effective testing scenarios for ourselves, and this may apply for other software-defined radio efforts, not sure. We have some single satellite tests, so we have zero and constant Doppler tests that basically, it's not representative of actual satellite dynamics, but it can be very useful for testing boundary conditions, or just getting your own kind of baseline non-dynamic performance. So this is where the satellite's staying put or it's moving at a constant rate. We also have normal satellite motion cases, which is basically what one would experience over the course of a 6-hour pass. And we can turn on unhealthy data to simulate that, or we can switch to these non-standard spreading codes, signal spreading codes. We have the full satellite constellation test, where we basically are doing the same thing as normal, except we have all that you would normally see in view, which could be depending on where you are and how high up you are. You may get, you know, up to 14 simultaneous tracking satellites. So it's good for trying to characterize the whole representative system performance under load. And we have some Monte Carlo simulations where we can vary the, really to try to characterize our probability of acquisition and false acquisition under different conditions like SNR, Doppler, and elevation angles. So in the future, some things that we want to do next. Now, faster than real-time testing is really, I think, the next thing we want to do that can speed up our tests dramatically. And we basically will run our simulators fast as possible and have the receiver process also as fast as possible. And that's a good way to also find where performance bottlenecks are. So it gives us another chance to uncover some things that we wouldn't normally see at real time, since we're only running at real time instead of faster than real time. We should be able to do continuous and distributed Monte Carlo testing. We should be able to vary these parameters and definitely distribute them out. And if we're running faster in real time, we can really start getting a lot of cases covered. And a little bit better automated analysis. We currently have reports that we generate, which makes it actually pretty quick, but it's manual review. If we're doing a lot more tests and we're doing it a lot faster, if we're going to need a better way, so maybe a scoreboard kind of thing. So a couple takeaways from my last slide here. You really need a combination of unit, baseband, and RF testing to feel good about any SDR system, in my opinion. If you're not doing all of these things, you're probably going to need more tests. You're probably missing some things. And it really helps you nail down the line between hardware and software, which can drive you crazy sometimes. So this really helps a lot, having baseband and RF there. And the other takeaway is build your own simulator. That'll enable baseband testing. It really gives you, it starts pulling back some of the, if you're just doing RF testing, you don't have that exact determinism. You can get that determinism back by doing a baseband, and it gives you complete control over your testing scenarios, and you don't have to depend on any third-party device. And that's it for me. Thanks.
Thank you, Andrew. And if anyone has questions for Andrew, please follow up with him in person, because we don't actually have time for them now.
Thank you.
Sorry.
No problem.